Hey everyone, I wanted to quickly go over the new and exciting news we got from Monster Hunter Rise on the Nintendo Switch. A few days ago, Capcom held a stream, basically in the middle of the night if you live in the West, showcasing a slew of games that are set to release in the near future, that actually culminated with a new gameplay clip for Monster Hunter Rise. We got a new chance to see the Frozen Isles, as well as a little bit of a hunt with a Somnacanth. So in this video, I actually want to do two separate things. First, go over what we actually saw on this new stream and break down some new facts regarding this monster and what we actually saw. And in the later half of the video, I actually want to go over my predictions of what we can expect to see in the three separate Capcom held streams for Monster Hunter Rise early next week. I will be talking about leaks as well, so if you don't wish to be spoiled, perhaps avoid that segment. But when it actually comes to the Frozen Isles gameplay that they showed, there's actually a lot to see here. They went over through a lot of just the explorable areas that you actually get to enjoy very early on in the map. A lot of endemic life pickups, some little tidbits that we actually didn't see before, even in the clips that Capcom does put out every couple of days. There was just a lot of little hidden segments that we just didn't get to see before. So it's actually really cool to see just a full kind of like fleshed out gameplay clip. I do believe IGN put one out back last month, but they were mostly focused on just kind of hunting the monster specifically. They didn't really focus on just exploring the area and for you to be able to just see what it has to offer. But in this one, they actually do spend quite a bit of time just kind of like gathering around and just getting ready before any specific hunt. In the later part of the gameplay, you actually do end up seeing a Somnacanth engagement and a little bit of a fight. They don't actually quite kill it. They just engage with it for the most part, and I think they end up putting it to sleep, and that's just kind of like where they cut away. It was a pretty long stream in general. I think it was about 2 hours long. They showed off a lot of games that just people weren't necessarily clamoring for to see. Ghosts and Goblins and things like that, which are fine on their own terms, but a lot of people were just really eager and hungry to see Monster Hunter Rise. The comments were very adamant about that. They just ended up showing like 6 minutes of gameplay, which wasn't necessarily a lot, but again, when you put it in context, there's like three separate streams next week, so we're actually going to be able to see a lot more of the game, and I'm going to talk about that in a bit. But necessarily when it comes to this, what they showed, Somnacanth is a really interesting monster in general, and some of the interviews they talked about how it's basically inspired by an otter, and its movements is just constantly zigzagging from left to right. It never usually stands still. It's just constantly shifting positions to basically just avoid being attacked in general. They do showcase, not just in this clip, but something that they talked about in the interviews, how it just kind of does different status effects and just kind of like different things. It basically cracks the shell open in its chest and it does different effects. It can do a paralyze, kind of like a flashbang effect, which Bishoten also does. It can do a sleep through the breath. I believe it can also poison, and it does like an AoE fire attack as well. It can like explosion itself, or the shell cracks open and explodes, or something similar to that effect. And it basically just like does AoE fire. So in general, it's a really interesting monster with like a lot of flexibility. It does dive bomb attacks. It like hangs a lot on its tail, and then just kind of like dive bombs on hunters and stuff like that. So in general, it's going to be a really interesting hunt. Trying to figure out the patterns is going to be a little tricky. It's just a good idea to have just different types of monsters like this that aren't necessarily typical to what we were used to seeing. In one of the developer interviews, they did talk about how it's inspired by sirens from Japanese and ancient lore. Not necessarily just sirens from the West, although there are influences. They explained that Japanese and Asian type sirens usually have the lower body of a snake or a serpent, but the top half of a demon or an oni, whereas Western sirens have the top half of a beautiful woman and the lower half of a fish. So visually, it does look more akin to Japanese or Asian type sirens of lore, but the singing aspect of it, which is actually something that you talked about, I guess with the sleep breath attack that it does, is more akin to like a Western siren in general. So in general, they did mix a lot of ideas for this one specific monster, and it's definitely cool to see them experiment with different just ideas and theories for monster types. It's definitely not a traditional type monster by far, so it's definitely cool to see. Transitioning over to what we can expect to see next week, let's remember that there's actually three separate streams, on Monday, on Tuesday, and on Thursday. On Monday, we can definitely expect to see a new trailer for Monster Hunter Rise. That's pretty much a given. And also probably the reveal for the new demo, which I'm guessing that is going to be on Tuesday, but I'll talk about that in a bit. They're also going to show some gameplay or even a trailer for Stories 2. I don't necessarily want to get into that because I don't know much about that game in general, but they're definitely going to be talking about it. They made that very clear already. Tuesday, there's going to be a developer Q&A, and they're most likely going to be showing the demo, specifically gameplay of it. Remember that if it comes to the leak specifically, Magna Malo is supposed to be the monster that you actually get to fight. And they're also going to be talking about things that you might have missed and those kind of like daily updates that they put out on Twitter. When it comes to Thursday, I think they're going to have streamers playing the demo. What does make me a little bit concerned or make me just question that the demo actually drops on Tuesday is that if they're going to have streamers playing the game on Thursday, chances are they'll probably drop the demo on Thursdays to have the streamers play it first and then have the demo release like an hour and a half or 2 hours after the streamers ended up playing it. This is something that they already did with the first demo, so if they follow that same pattern, then that would probably mean that the demo actually drops on Thursday instead of Tuesday. I'm speculating Tuesday because it makes the most amount of sense, but I could be wrong about that. But when it actually comes to things that we haven't seen regarding the leaks, it's worth considering that there were supposed to be 5 fully fledged trailers shown before the launch of the game. So far, we've only actually seen 4, and things kind of been shown out of whack in the past few trailers. For example, some things were shown in the second trailer that were actually supposed to be part of the third, and then the fourth and fifth trailer in general ended up getting merged all together into one massive trailer where they showed both the sandy plains and the molten area. So in general, they just kind of mixed up things all together, which leads to question what actually ends up being shown in the fifth trailer. And that's actually the things that I want to go over specifically right now. Remember, this is all actually based on things that the leak said were supposed to be shown. And these are just basically the handful of things that we actually haven't been able to see on any of the previous trailers. So starting out with the Rampage, although they did show it in the last previous trailer, they still can showcase just a bit more about it. Specifically, how it still is very own game mode, and that's something that we actually have already seen in one of the menu screenshots. But they haven't actually gone into details of what does that actually mean in real gameplay terms. Another thing that's actually mentioned is Rampage boosting, which is actually tied to that. This is clearly mentioned in part of the leaks, and while I'm not necessarily sure what it could mean in actual gameplay, it does have to do with clearing the Rampage runs to raise up your level of the village. Remember that offline quests are also tied to the story. So if you're doing like offline quests and village quests by themselves, they don't have anything to do with online questing. So if they tie the Rampage to you basically farming the Rampage over and over, and that raises the level of your village, that's an easy way for them to be able to just kind of get you to just do the Rampage over and over. It does remind me of like Monster Hunter Generations Ultimate, where towards the end game, they had you leveling up a specific quest up to like 10 levels if you wanted to be able to just hunt the hardest, toughest version of one of those like end game monsters that they had available. So basically, I think that if it ends up meaning the same thing that I think it does, they'll have you just doing the Rampage quest offline over and over to just level up your village, make the monsters that appear in the village quests, and specifically the Rampages, a little bit more tougher. This also is tied to the Apex monsters. Remember that Valstrax and Arceros are the two ones that we know of, but you know, there's gonna be more Apex monsters gonna be shown as well. We don't know what they could end up being, but you know, this is all tied together. Weapon combo swaps is another thing that's also being talked about in the leak that's not being shown yet. This refers to you being able to switch out your Wirebug attacks based on the pairs that they have available to you. All the details of this was actually talked about in the Datamine leak that I put out a few months back, so I'd actually refer back to that video for more details, but essentially, since that Datamine came out, and since they actually just talked about different Wirebug attacks, they showed different Wirebug attacks than the ones that are available in the demo, but they never actually set out to name any one of them. So if you actually haven't been following the leaks, chances are you don't know that there's different Wirebug attacks for each one of the weapons. 3 pairs and 6 different Wirebug attacks in general for each one of the weapons. Chances are you don't know anything about that. So this is probably a good time to be able to just introduce that idea that as you level up your character, as you basically just get stronger throughout, you know, just doing missions and harder star quests and stuff like that, chances are you're going to be able to unlock in weapon swaps to be able to just do different Wirebug attacks in general. So this is actually something that I do expect them to touch upon, or at least at the very least, just talk about, like, in the most basic terms, like, hey, if you don't like this wire bug attack, that's cool. You're going to be able to have other ones that you can swap into in the near future or something like that. The last two things that aren't necessarily detailed in the leak, and I actually hesitate to mention, but I do think that they're worth remembering, is that there are two new monsters that haven't been shown, Ibushi Makihiko and Naruha Tahime. These are the two endgame serpents that we know are part of the game to round out the roster of 10 new monsters for this title. I don't necessarily want to go into the details again because they were like talked about during the data mine where we got full scripts of what they're supposed to be and what their connection is to the village and all of that. So I don't want to get into that. There's a video that I already put out a month and a half ago. It's in my video description. You can see that if you want to go search it out. But I'm not necessarily sure what's actually Capcom's track record for showing endgame monsters just before the game releases and if they actually show them. They might just tease their connection to the twin sisters from the village, but I'm not necessarily sure if they're even willing to go that far. They might tease them, like a, you know, show a shadowy figure of one of the serpents or anything like that, but I'm not sure if they're actually willing to show them. I don't know what their track record is when it comes to previous games showing the bosses for those games, or specifically the last monsters that you'll be able to hunt, like the toughest ones. This is why I hesitate to even bring that up, because, you know, it's just, it changes from game to game, so I'm not sure. But also tied to that, they could definitely talk about the post-launch DLC. This is originally talked about back in September of last year, where they actually officially mentioned that the game would be getting post-launch DLC, but didn't actually go into details. We do know, based on the leak, that Camellios is based to be the leaked first DLC monster. Just kind of like the two serpents, I'm not necessarily sure if they're going to go into details of saying, like, hey, this is going to be the first new monster that we're going to show you post-launch. They might actually want to save that for like a launch day trailer or something like that. But again, this is like basic information that I think they could just easily show to just get fans even more excited. Like, hey, we got more things coming. You don't have to worry about just, you know, us forgetting about this game because the PC version is coming out or anything like that. It's not going to be the case. But it is worth remembering that Monster Hunter World monsters are expected to be the bulk of the early first DLC. Odogoron and I think Gyros is one of those other monsters that I've heard seen mentioned. Great Gyros, like that black lizard with yellow stripes on it or whatever. Those are the two names that I've seen actually being thrown around on top of Camellios as well. So I'm not saying that I know or anything, but those are definitely the names that I've seen mentioned when it comes to like early DLC monsters that we can expect to see after the launch of the game. But yeah, that's basically going to be it for this video. I'm definitely interested to see what they're going to be showing. I think the developer Q&A is a really interesting one because if they actually pick some really good questions, and again, a lot of people post questions like, is my favorite gun monster going to be in the game? You know, it's like, it's a wasted question. They're not going to answer that. But if they actually pick some interesting questions to reveal more information, we might actually get more details on the Q&A more than actually the trailer. Because the trailer, if they actually focus specifically on just the village and the two new monsters, that's just going to be story spoilers, and I'm not necessarily sure people are interested in seeing that. And when it comes to like new monster reveals, again, there's only two new monsters that they're going to show and a bunch of returning ones. So it's like, yeah, like Sunogre and like Nargacuga, being able to see both of them in the trailer would be cool. But it's like, I'd rather have a new monster. So, yeah. But either way, I'm sure everyone's excited to look forward to what they actually have to show early next week. So if you're new to my channel, be sure to leave a like and subscribe. And as always, thank you so much for watching. See ya.